Good afternoon, everyone. So in this session, we are going to discuss how managed business processes can help you in gaining more control over your organization. So before starting, can I see how many of you are using business processes in your organizations? So are you using automated processes? Are you using automated processes? So yeah, that is one step. So in this session, we are going to look into what other things that we can do beyond just automating processes. So first, let's look how we do business today. So in today's environment, a business looks something like this. We have a large number of entities in any organization. Basically, we have multiple branches or multiple offices, or sales outlets, partners, suppliers, and these all entities are distributed across multiple states, cities, or even countries. So this is the picture of a modern organization. Then, if you want to gain control over this, we have to do two things. First, we have to monitor each and every part of our organization. Then we should be able to enforce policies to control certain aspects of our organization. So these are the main two things that we need to do in order to gain control. But the problem is that now our organization is a large collection of distributed entities. So it is a challenge to do these two operations in an organization like this. So if it, so let's take a single task that we do in our organization, a task like processing a sales order. Even for this single task, there are too many entities involved. For example, we have customers, and we multiple employees may be involved, and multiple IT systems can be involved, and also partners, suppliers, and even some small things like trucks, cargo boxes, items, and all these things are involved in performing this single task. Therefore, even to control this single task is a challenge. But if we look into this in a process point of view, we get a different picture. So because for each and every task we do in our organization, there's an underlying process. So what we can do is that we can take that process and map all each of these entities that are involved in that process to the steps in our process. So once we do that, we get a bit clear picture. So we can consider this as wiring up an organization. So so this is the basis of creating a process-oriented organization. So once we do that, we can do a whole lot of interesting things, basically to allow us to gain more control. Now, before doing that, first we have to create these processes. So let's consider what are the concerns that we have to consider when we are creating processes. First is that how many processes do we have to create? So obviously, we can think of some prominent processes like sales order processing, or managing supplies, and so on. But that is not enough. If you want to gain full control, we have to consider all tiny bits. For example, in an organization, there can be processes for small things, like, for example, applying a leave, or allocating a parking lot for an employee. All these things are processes. So we have to consider all these things. Therefore, we will end up with a large collection of processes. Then the other part is what needs to be captured in a process. Again, there are multiple things. So if we take a process like this, for each step, there can be one or more employees involved. And in addition, there can be IT systems involved in these steps, and also inputs and outputs. So these inputs and outputs can be documents, for example. Then another important aspect is that we can associate key performance indicators for these steps. Those are the values that we need to measure for each of these steps. For example, for this task, maybe we want to measure the time frame or cost for that task. So we have to capture all these things for a process. So with this, we understand that capturing processes is not an easy task. Then let's say that we have captured our processes. Now what we can do with that? So we have a process collection. Now we have users for these processes. Now these users should be able to discover relevant processes. For example, if an employee needs to apply for a leave, he should be able to go to the process collection and discover the relevant process. So once he discovers the process, either he can follow the steps mentioned in the process, or if the process is automated, he can directly execute the process in a process server. So that is one aspect. Then there's another interesting thing. So if we capture all our processes, and if we have some measures to collect data from these processes, then we can understand the behavior of our organization. For example, we can understand what are the processes that take most time to complete, or what are the bottlenecks of processes, or what are the most demanding processes in certain periods. So these things are the key measurements that we need to understand if we want to gain more control. So as you saw already, these things are not easy. So we need a tool for that. So what is the tool? So in WSO2, we have a new product called WSO2 Process Center, which exactly caters for this need. So basically, the process center acts as a central place to manage all business processes in your organization. So this is a brief overview about the process center. Basically, first we need to create processes. So for that, we have to use editors. So these editors can be BPMN editors, text editors, or anything. So these editors are integrated with the process center. Then if the processes are automated, we have to use process servers. Therefore, these process servers are also integrated with the process center. Then once processes are executed, we can collect execution data from those processes. And once we collect them, we can analyze them using WSO2 Data Analytics Server. Therefore, this WSO2 DAS product or Data Analytics Server is also integrated with the process center. Then the last part is that once we have all this setup in place, we can analyze processes and also we can optimize or improve processes. Therefore, we have analysis dashboards and other mechanisms to optimize and improve processes, which is also built into our process center. So that is an overview of the product. Now let's look at one use case. This is about creating and using processes. So basically, process owners or domain experts can create processes using any editor. Once they create it, they can store those processes in the process center. Then we have process participants. Those can be employees of the organization or partners or anyone. They can just go to the process center and discover the processes relevant to them. Then they can basically use it. Then there's another user group, which are developers, who are more technically oriented people. They can also get the processes from process center and create executable processes out of them. And once executable models are created, they can deploy those processes in the process server. Once you do that, we can associate executable processes also with the process center. Therefore, process participants can directly trigger the execution of executable processes from the process center. So as you saw here, the process execution is only a single part of this whole picture. Now, what are the things that we can do with this scenario? First, we can facilitate process search. So as you saw early, we have to discover processes. So for that, we can provide multiple mechanisms. One is that we can provide tag and metadata-based search, which is a bit simple. Then also we can have a process text-based search. Then another interesting thing is that we can support a graph-based search, because if we take process models, for example, BPMN model or BPL model, we can consider that as a graph. Therefore, we can have graph query mechanisms on top of our process center. For example, we can give a section of a BPMN model and ask the process center to find out all process models containing this section. So we can do queries like that. Then another important thing is that we can facilitate process standardization. Let's say that we have modeled most of our processes in our organization so that we have a large collection of processes. Now, there can be some sections within these processes which are similar. Let's take these two processes. This process is dealing with order handling, and this one is dealing with repair request handling. So these are two different processes, but there are similar sections. Because both these processes are dealing with shipping items, that the process section for shipping items are similar. So if we want to standardize our organization, we want to standardize these sections so that we can ask process center to find me all similar sections across our collection, so that then we can impose some standardization measures on them. Then another case is process reuse. So as we saw earlier, creating process models is not that easy. So let's say that we are creating a model, in the middle of creating a model, and in one part of the model, we want to have a section for shipping an item. So without creating that process section from scratch, we can ask process center to find me all process sections dealing with shipping items. So then the process center can list you or suggest you a collection of sections that can satisfy your need. Then you can simply pick the one suitable for you and complete your model. So like that, we can facilitate process reuse. So that is one aspect or one functionality that we can get from process center. Now there's another part that is about process analysis. Now once you have a process collection, and then we have some processes automated and deployed in the process center, so we can collect process-related events from the executing processes. So if it is executing in a process server, we can obviously get events from that. But even if it is not executing in process center, still we can collect some events, because some parts of those processes are running in IT systems or some devices are involved with that, so that we can collect events from them. Therefore, we can push all those events to the data analytics server associated with the process center. And from that, we can generate analysis results on these processes and get dashboards to understand the process behavior. So we'll look into this later. So before that, let's understand what are process events. So if we take a process like this, if we take an instance of that process that has already been completed, we can get data like process start time, process end time, and who is the initiator of the process. So we can get those data for this completed instance. Then if we take a task also, for each completed task, we can get data attributes like task start time, task end time, and the assignee of the task, and so on. And even we can get task specific data attributes like shipping cost, city, and so on. So by combining these data attributes, we can generate events. For example, for each completed event, each completed process instance, we can get events like this one. And for each completed task instance, we can get events like this one. So once we collect these events, we can do a whole lot of things. One is process monitoring. That means we can monitor how existing processes are performing. So we can get a dashboard like this. So here, by mapping those events to the process model, we can highlight the current position of the process. And also, we can visualize or show the data values of completed tasks. For example, here it says that order items task has taken 6 days, and supplier was something called BG Inc. Then also, we can compute other values like total duration taken for the process so far and total cost that has taken, and so on. So that is monitoring. Then more interesting part is process analysis. That is about analyzing historical process instances. Now, once we start collecting these events, we can aggregate these events for a large period of time, for example, for 1 year. Then we can analyze all processes that has been executed within that year. Now, by analyzing that, we can generate dashboards like that. For example, here in the top left corner, we have a visualization of average durations of a collection of processes. Now, here you can see that this order handling process has taken the most time to complete. So we may want to understand the reason for that. Therefore, we can drill down that and get to this dashboard, which visualizes the task execution times of that process. So if you go recall that order handling process, which we discussed here, it has tasks like order item, negotiate discounts, and so on. So for each of these tasks, here it visualizes the average execution times. So from here, we know that order items task has taken the most time, most of the time. Therefore, we want to further analyze that task. So we go to the disk visualization. Here, we can see the user involvements for that task. That means, who are the users that were involved in completing that task. So here we know that James has been involved in completing most task instances for that task, and also Kane is also involved for many tasks. So we can further drill down users from here and analyze their behaviors. So for example, here we drill down the Kane's behavior. So we get to the user experience visualization. So here what we see is that what are the tasks that the given user is involved in, and how many task instances has that user completed. So with this visualization, we know that Kane was involved mostly in shortlisting suppliers, and he's not that much experienced in ordering items. Therefore, by this visualization, we may decide that we should not allocate Kane for order items tasks because his experience is in another task. So like that, we can think of ways to optimize our processes by using this analysis data. Then this is another analysis visualization. Here we are visualizing a distribution of orders against different cities. So here you can see that we get most orders from New York and San Francisco. And we get very few orders from Boston and Denver. Therefore, we may want to analyze why, how our sales agents in Boston and Denver are performing. So we can go to this visualization. So the interesting thing here is that we can generate all these visualizations just from those process data. Now, by drilling down the sales data for Denver and Boston by the quarter of years, so we can get visualizations like this. So from here, we know that the orders from Denver were decreasing gradually, and orders from Boston were increasing. Therefore, the sales agent in Boston is improving, although the current number of sales is not that good. But the sales agent is in Denver is not performing good because his orders are decreasing all the time. So therefore, by this visualization, we may decide to replace the sales agent in Denver. So like that, we can come to interesting conclusions just by looking into these process events and going to visualizations from them. So far, we were just visualizing the data attributes that we have directly taken from process events. But we can do more. We can combine these multiple data attributes to construct new performance indicators. For example, here we have constructed a new performance indicator called transport percentage by adding up supplier transport cost and order shipping cost and dividing that by order value. So our conclusion is that if the transport percentage is high, the profit we are getting from that is not that significant. Then we have a dashboard item like this. We can have a dashboard item like this. And also we can drill down that, for example, by city. So by this drill down, we know that the overall transport percentage for Chicago and Denver are high, so that we are not getting that much profit from their sales. So that is another conclusion that we can get from such visualizations. So that is one aspect. So another thing that we can do with these process events is process optimizations. That means we can map these process events to the models that we have in our collection and understand how we can improve our processes. So again, let's take this process, which is about allocating parking lots in a university. Now, we get requests for parking lot allocations, and with each request, we get the distance to the university and the status of the applicant. That can be lecturer, undergraduate, or postgraduate, or something, and the time of year. And also, from this step, we can know the status of the application that can be approved or not. Now, by analyzing this data, we can come to conclusions like this. So we know that applications are rejected if an undergrad lives within 10 kilometers applied in Q1. So therefore, it is a waste of time and resources to continue processing such applications until this step. So we can optimize the process by introducing new steps here. So what we do here is that we introduce a gateway here, and we add a new step here, which is the assessment step. So this alternative path is triggered only if our criteria matches. That means if the distance is lesser than 10 kilometers and status is undergraduate and time is Q1. So someone can work on this step and reject the application then and there without continuing the process to this step. So like that, process center can analyze this historical data and suggest improvements to processes. So this is only one type of improvement. So we can improve on other things like user assignments, service allocations, and so on. So there are many things that we can improve in this aspect. Then there's another interesting area where we combine processes and Internet of Things, or smart devices. Now let's take this part of this process, which is about shipping some item. So we have three steps here. One is to load the item, and one is to transport the item to the port, and one is to ship the package. Now, to get such analysis visualizations that we saw earlier, we need to capture data about each of these steps. So how we usually do it is a human user has to enter that data manually, which is not that scalable thing. Again, there's a limit of data that we can capture by that method. So what we can do is that we can introduce smart devices here. So what if the forklift that is loading the package can send data itself without waiting for a human operator? And what if the truck that is transporting the package can send data about the package ID, loaded time, and driver of the truck, and so on? So then we can simply enrich our process with data without involving human users, so that we can do very comprehensive analysis about our processes. So that is one area that we can improve with IoT and processes. Then there's another aspect that is about improving processes. Now again, let's take the same process model, and let's assume that there's a crane involved in loading these packages to the ship. Now this crane is also smart, so that it can also send events. So for each package it loads, it sends events like package ID, pickup time, loaded time, and so on. And process center can capture these events as well. And then by analyzing the timestamps, it can understand that there's some other task that is between transport to port and ship package, so that it can propose adding a new task there to map to that new data stream, which is to load to ship. Likewise, if we can get data from these smart devices, the process center can suggest process improvements, and also it can identify hidden tasks in our process. So that is how business processes can help you in gaining control of your organization. So this is, in summary, this is what we have discussed. So we have an organization here, and yes, you want to monitor your organization and enforce some control policies on your organization. So, but the problem is that you have a large collection of entities distributed across multiple places, so it is hard to do this. So what you can do is that you can introduce the WSO2 products, basically the process center and other business process related products here, and let them do the job for you so that you can gain more control of your organization. So that is it, basically.